navigation and work we've been doing over the last few years in this area. It was actually quite nice that Paul mentioned meeting me at a conference a long time ago, because I actually, in preparation for this talk, I looked back at my very first conference talk and what I said in it. And what I was describing was a model I built for my PhD of cricket behaviour. You can maybe hear the chirping. So this is a female cricket that's running towards the chirping, coming from a speaker. She doesn't need an actual male cricket there, the sound is enough. And in my PhD work, I built a Lego robot that imitated this behaviour, and that included imitating some of the auditory system in a physical, the physical auditory system in an electronic circuit, and then also programming it with a neural network to do this behavior. But I was particularly struck by the fact that my conclusion slide, which I've simply reproduced exactly what that was here, made a set of points about what I was doing and what I was trying to do that is scarily similar to what I had planned to have as the conclusion slide of this talk. So we can kind of skip it if you like. Basically, all these points that I make here are things that I'm still trying to do. So I'm trying to use the robotics to support hypotheses and suggest directions for the insect research for biology, but also trying to build competent robots using biology as an inspiration. And in the process of doing that, finding that we often come up with simpler mechanisms. Using a robot model is important because it means you're actually having to deal with the real world in some way. And I also think it's very important that I'm targeting an actual biological system, so not just kind of imagining some kind of biological system, but actually saying, what does this real existing biological system do? So in my current conference talk, I'm going to move on to a different insect. And this is the ant, this lovely video from Antoine. It's actually of an Australian desert ant. And it's a high-speed video, so you can see this is slowed down. And these ants move really, really fast through the desert. And they're very, very motivated to bring food back to their nest. And because they have to move so fast in very hot surroundings, they don't use chemical trails like other ants, but rather each ant individually navigates to its nest. And if they don't succeed in doing that, they will die quite quickly out there. And also the colony will die if a good proportion of the ants don't get back. And they also do this over quite amazing distances. They've been shown to track, to forage over a kilometre away from their nest and come back. And they can also do it, as you can see here, in fairly cluttered or complex terrain. So in this talk, I'm going to talk about the various models we've been building of this behaviour, but also trying to draw out some general lessons that I think I've learned over the last 20 years of research in this area. So the first lesson, as I said, refers back to where I started, the idea of trying to stay connected to the real world. So obviously all these suggestions are things that are ideals, and we don't always meet these ideals completely, but for example, I think it was quite important for me to move from looking at crickets behaving in a lab to ants behaving in their actual natural environment, and also to be not just looking at a real animal, but an animal that's doing what it's good at. So these animals are very good at navigation. We're not setting up some very artificial experiment that the ants have to spend ages and ages to learn to do because it's not natural. It's actually what they're built to do. And I should emphasize that nearly all the work I'm talking about involves Michael Mandan, who many of you know, who's at the back there. So this is the study that he did during his PhD, where he was looking at the behaviour of this caterpillar spelox ant in Sevilla, and looking at its navigation from a nest to a feeder through this somewhat cluttered environment. So that's one half of the stem connected to the real world, and the other, obviously, is the robotic part. So this is our robo-ant, which is really just a mobile phone on wheels. But mobile phones make a great robot base because they have a huge amount of the things you need. They have cameras, they have lots of different sensors, they can show you immediately what they're doing on their screen, you can communicate with them. This robot app has its own Gmail account, so if you want to talk to it. So it's a fairly simple concept for a robot, but by putting an omnidirectional lens up here, we can actually get an anti-eye view of the world. And in fact, Alex, who's an undergraduate working particularly with Michael, actually took this robot out to Seville as well. So we've actually tested it in the field as well. So that's kind of what we're really aiming to do, if possible, is understand a real behavior of a real animal, build models of it, and actually test those models on robots in the field. So as I said, that's the kind of ideal. We don't always reach that. But on the way to doing that, one of the important things is really getting to know your animal. And I can't encourage too much those of you who are engineers, computer scientists, modelers, to really try sometime to do your own experiments, particularly behavioural experiments on animals. They're not difficult to get into. And you learn so much by actually doing the experiments yourselves, observing the animal yourself. At the very least, try and spend some, if you're working in collaboration with someone, try to spend a good amount of time in their lab understanding what they're doing. And in particular, actually, it's turned out for us to be very useful to be essentially engineers and computer scientists moving into biology, because we can leverage a lot of our technical know-how to improve our data collection, our analysis techniques to do better, to get better information about the animals. So this is a study that Mike Mangan, here again, did a few years ago while he was a postdoc with me. And we were basically trying to understand what do ants see. So we know that ants can navigate, but what's not so clear is how much information have they acquired before we see them doing, you know, a 1 kilometer navigation or navigation through a complex environment. Perhaps they've spent, you know, days and days learning about their environment, building up a map. We don't really know. So the aim of this study was to follow these ant foragers for their entire life, foraging lifetime, i.e. from the very first time they ever came out of the nest and saw the world, and to see how long they had to spend maybe building up their tracks and so forth, and to be able to then in our models be able to copy that so that we could give our robot exactly the same amount of experience and see if it could do what the ants could do. And this actually, as I said, leveraged quite a lot of technology. It's probably a technological overkill. So as you can see, this is actually a differential GPS unit. The ant will be somewhere down here. So this is what Mike is carrying, so he can get rough around 2 centimeter accuracy of following the ant. And he had it designed with these laser pointers pointing down so that he could make sure he stayed above the ant, which is here. And then he could follow it around in this environment near Seville, where we basically had a nest in the middle here that we'd surrounded by a bucket so that we could control when the ants went in and out, and therefore we could know by marking the ants which ones had come out before, which ones hadn't, and know when we had a new ant and then follow that particular ant. And we would let the ants forage until they reached this kind of 8 meter circle that you can see here, and then we give them some food and then go back, and you'll see the results in a moment. But I just wanted to sort of give you a flavour of what this looks like. So, sorry about this. This is Mike and Antoine following the ants around. So Antoine was kind of doing the ant handling, and Mike was carrying the GPS. So you can see it's it was, as I said, these are desert ants. They work in very hot environments. So this is like 40 degree heat. Not a natural environment for Mike Mangan, who's from Scotland. But he got used to it. Okay. So, from this, although we're using differential GPS, where we're going towards with this is actually being able to use SLAM methods to reconstruct where the camera was. So instead of having to know where the camera was from the GPS, a potentially much cheaper method is to just film it and then use SLAM, simultaneous localization and mapping, to keep track of where the... Sorry, I wanted to jump this ahead a little bit, but it doesn't seem to be quite good to go. Let's see. Okay, so you can maybe get the idea. So what you're doing in simultaneous localization mapping is mapping different points on the ground and using those to reconstruct the path of your camera. So you can actually get not just the XY path, but also the Z path, pan and tilt. So you can actually get a very precise idea of where your camera is pointing in real space over time. So we can then combine that with actually tracking the ant, and this is really nice work that's been done by a new postdoc of mine, Benjamin Risser. So you might find it hard to see the ant, in fact, but he's managing to track this ant, so this little red circle is the ant of interest. You can maybe see it better. You can see how cluttered this log is that they're moving through, but they're moving through it very quickly and successfully. And he's also amazingly able to track this ant through this really difficult terrain, even when some other ants would pass, and so on. So we can then, from those two things, from knowing where the camera is and knowing the track of the ant in the camera, we can reconstruct the exact track of the ant. And then, finally, we've also been working on actually reconstructing the world of the ant. And in this case, we actually did some laser scans of this area. And again, this is Benjamin has put together this kind of simulation of the world of the ant. So each of these thistles is actually modeled on the real thistles that are in the ant's world. So each one is different, and it's actually identical to the thistle that was in the world there. I think we did over 1,000 thistles in here. And then finally, we can kind of do this from the ant's point of view, and I should say this exact video is actually from a fly's point of view, but it's a similar sort of fly. So this is what the ant can see when it's navigating. So I hope you can appreciate that navigating through this world, it's not a simple, it doesn't look like a simple thing to do. You seem to have lots of thistles that look almost exactly the same at extremely low resolution, but nevertheless, they seem to be able to do this. Okay, so here's some of the results, and I should say the results I'm going to show you are actually just from the GPS tracks rather than the really detailed tracks. But each of the clumps here now is basically a clump of thistles. So we mapped out the entire area, and then we look at what the ant does. So this ant, the first time it ever came out, it basically, you probably can't even see, there's a little blue bit here, it came out of the nest and went back in again. It went, you know, maybe 10 centimeters, no more. The second time, it did basically the same thing. It came out, went back in. The third time, it went a little bit further, and this starts to look like, is it doing some kind of learning walk? So it comes, it explores a little bit out this way, and then turns around and goes back into the nest. So it's come maybe half a meter away from the nest this time. However, the fourth time, it was off. It didn't bother to learn anything more. It maybe made one loop back towards the nest, and then it went foraging, and it was going to go until it found food. So it forages out in this path, and when it gets to this 8-meter boundary, we get the food, and then it goes basically straight back to the nest. And this ability to go straight back to the nest, we know from lots of study of lots of ants over a long time, is in fact due to path integration. The ant is actually integrating its path all the way along the route. It's using compass information from the sky, from the polarization thing in the sky, and people think counting its steps to know the distance and integrating that throughout its path so that it can actually go directly home. And ants are very, very good at this. What it does next is actually not only can it get home, it can also remember then which direction the food was. So the next time it comes out, it basically comes out and goes directly to the food along this vector, not exactly the path it took, but basically in that direction, and it gets the food. And then it goes back again. Here, a little bit less directly, it kind of bounces around here and gets back to the nest. So it's now been out to the nest twice. So what we do is we pick it up and see what happens if we now put it back at the food. Has it learned enough about its world to be able to get home, even though it doesn't have path integration? So if we move it, it's what we call a zero vector ant, because it's got home, its vector of where home is says, I am home, I'm at zero, but now we're just moving it back to where it started. So the ant is displaced back to the food, but she still manages to get home fairly efficiently. There's a bit of looking around, but you can see what she's doing is basically each time she intersects this path that she did before, she seems to recognize it and run along it. And basically, she gets home pretty quickly. And in fact, I'll show you in a moment, if you let ants do this over and over, they become very efficient at following this path. But just to show that this also isn't because there's, you know, maybe there's some really obvious visual or chemical beacon at the nest that she can use to get home, if you move her and put her somewhere where she hasn't been, so she hasn't been through this part of the environment then she's quite lost, and she basically just starts doing a search path until she finds her way back. So it's clear that there's a clear difference between what she can do in the places she's been before versus the places she hasn't been before. Okay, so as I said, in an earlier study, Michael had kind of looked at these ants, letting them run lots and lots of times to and from the food. And what you see, and people had seen this in other species of ants as well, is that they form very consistent idiosyncratic routes. So a particular ant will develop her own route that she follows all the time. And she actually has a different route that she follows outward from the nest, and that she follows, outwards from the nest to the food, and then another route that she follows from the food back to the nest. And this is something like 10 or 12 routes over several days, and she just keeps following the same one each time going around. And a different ant will have a slightly different one. Of course, because it was initially formed through path integration, it's going to be roughly straight. But because of the complicated world, some ants might come around this way, for example, or some ant might come around this way. And each ant will be very consistent. And you can show that they know this route despite not having path integration, again, by doing these kind of experiments where you pick them up from one place and put them somewhere else on their route. And they just seem to be fine, they can follow the route. And similarly here, picking them up from the nest, so the zero vector, put her at any arbitrary place on the route and she can follow the route. If you put her somewhere off the route, she'll start to search, and as soon as she crosses the route, she can follow the route. So she seems to have learned to follow this route. And we have pretty good evidence that this is a visual memory. So it's not that there's any parameter or anything, it's visual memory that she's using to follow this route. Okay, so people have, again, known for a long time that ants do this, and there's lots of theories out there. We were particularly interested in a nice theory that in particular had the nice property that it's a simple way to do the problem. It's less complicated than you might expect to solve this problem. Which is that ants basically don't actually recognize where they are. It's not that they know the route in the sense of knowing each segment of the route and what leads to what and so forth, but rather that they just learn everything as they're going home. They just learn everything they see as they go home. And what they try to do when they go home again is to align themselves in a direction that looks familiar. So they'll just, I've actually put the algorithm here, it's very straightforward. When you first go along this route, following your path integration vector, you store every view that you see, and then on the next one, assuming you don't have your path integrator, you basically just look around and compare what you currently see to everything you've ever seen before. And what you'll find is that if you align exactly with the direction you were facing before, in a place you were before, then that would look very familiar, and that's the direction you want to go. So this is kind of illustrated here. If this is these are 80 places along the route, and this is kind of swinging plus or minus 60 degrees in your heading direction, and you can see that you get a really good match when you're actually aligned, and the match kind of lasts also if you're a little bit displaced, it will also work reasonably well. And what you can do then is essentially follow this little valley of familiarity. So it's like, you know, a very simple way to get home is that you just follow the valley of familiarity that's there. So that's nice, it was a nice idea. And all well and good, but the question is, you know, is this realistic that this is what's happening in the brain of an ant? It's a nice algorithm for a robot cat, so could an ant really be doing something like this? This group in Sussex actually did also implement it on using an Inframax neural network, but they didn't make any claim that was a, you know, plausible neural network for their insert. So we were a bit interested to say, well, can we actually come up with something that we know about the insect's brain that could maybe do this? And initially that looked like a pretty hopeless task, because there's this statement that nothing is known about neural implementation of navigational space in insects. And this is from a review paper from 2015, as you can see, it's fairly recent. And by two people who know insect navigation very well and insect brains very well. However, it's not quite as hopeless as it sounds, because what we do actually know quite a lot about is the pattern learning capabilities of insect brains. And if you think about it, all we're talking about here is a pattern learning capability to see lots of images, store them, and be able to recognize them when you see them again. So people have done a lot of work on olfactory learning in insects. And it's been localized to this area of the insect brain called the mushroom bodies. because it's supposed to look a little bit like a mushroom. And indeed, what actually happens, at least this is the kind of working hypothesis people have for how this works, is that the information about the odors gets into the antenna lobe, and where it basically forms a spatiotemporal pattern that's unique to each odor. That pattern is taken by these projection neurons into the mushroom body, and this group of Kenyan cells, and the key point here is there's a much larger number of Kenyan cells than projection neurons, so it's like you're projecting your pattern into a high-dimensional space. So any of you who know through machine learning, like support vector machines, it's a very similar principle that you're trying to put things into a high-dimensional space so that then you can find a simple way to classify them. So the idea then is that what happens is that you have a sparse pattern here that represents the particular odor, and what you do is you learn the connections between that pattern and the particular information about that odor that you want to store. So in this case, maybe you're giving a shock to the insect whenever it gets that odor, or you're giving it sugar whenever it gets that odor, and so you simply connect, strengthen or change the connections between the neurons that represent that odor and this particular piece of information. So it's a fairly straightforward learning mechanism. And we've done some work previously with Jan Vestnitz, another postdoc of mine. We built a spiking model of the circuit and used it to do some models of olfactory learning. Very simple learning like this, where you give the animal an odor and give it a shock, and it learns to change its behavior. Or here, these are Drosophila larvae that are learning to associate the odor with sugar, and then they're more likely to go towards that odor in the future. So we've been building these models, but it's very simple associative learning. So the question was, could this same architecture actually support learning something as complicated as a whole set of patterns, a large number of visual patterns along a route? So this nice picture extending that network was drawn by Antoine, and the work, the concept is really very simple. It just says, well, let's just have exactly the same idea, except instead of projecting visual, olfactory patterns, we're now going to also project visual patterns. So if you take a relatively unprocessed view of the scene, this is the insect's visual system, and assume that that's also getting projected into the same set of Kenyan cells, again with sparse connections, so that the pattern here is becoming a sparse pattern here. And what the animal has to learn is patterns that it sees while it's going home, and remember that those patterns are things that it saw while it's going home, or alternatively, there are patterns that it saw while it was going away from home, so that it maybe can remember those two things separately and use them separately. And indeed, this needn't just be a visual pattern, the ad could also be including some olfactory information. If there's, for example, something smells strange as it goes along its route, that can become part of the memory. There could be other sensory inputs, such as the wind direction and so forth. But so I like to think of it as a kind of, it's learning a gestalt about, is this place and this heading familiar or not? So that's the hypothesis, that we could learn it that way. So the question was, does it work? And obviously I wouldn't be telling you about it if it didn't work. So, but basically we built a spiking neural network and we fed it with images. So this is what we're doing, we're simulating the antibody view. So again, this is Mike collecting images in the field. So this is the ant field we used for originally looking at these root studies. And then you could build basically from the images a reconstruction of the ant's world. And then we could simulate the ant's point of view. And this again is just to give you a sense of what the ant is doing here. This is it going from this is a real ant route from the feeder to the nest. These are images taken along that route. This is a kind of reconstruction of what you could see from the ant's point of view, and this is something closer to ant-eye resolution. So again, I want to impress on you, the ant sees this once or twice, and then it can follow it again and get home. I still think it's quite amazing that they're capable of doing this. And it turns out that the mushroom body network that I've described can support this behavior. So basically, we train the mushroom body network using different routes through this environment that we've seen actual ants take, and storing up to 80 images along that route. So basically, it's an 8-meter route, so every 10 centimeters, we'd store an image. And then we tested, can we actually find our way along the route again using mushroom body memory?
Yeah.
And the idea is basically you look around, you make a choice about which direction to go by looking to see which direction looks most familiar, which in this case meant a smaller output from the mushroom body models, because what we were doing was actually turning off the synapses. So if you had a visual pattern that's a sparse pattern in the Kenyan cells, we turn off the synapses to the output. So basically, you wouldn't get any output as long as things look familiar, and if things started to look unfamiliar, then those synapses were still active, so you would turn around. And basically, so if you try and do this as a way of route following, and we basically had a simple measure of how many errors you were making along the route, and it turns out that if you do this with a perfect memory, i.e. you've actually stored all the images and you search through all the images literally, you can do it pretty well with very few errors. But also if you use a mushroom body memory, where you're just laying, each image is being laid on top of the other one, so it's just one set of neurons, but they're getting all the images, it also works pretty well. And in fact, it works well if you're on the route, but it also still works quite well, maybe you can't see these arrows, to give you the right general direction you should go, even if you're a little bit off the route. So basically, this mushroom body memory of the views you've seen before can guide successful routes. So one thing we realized, you know, one obvious question that we got asked when we did this work was, what is the memory capacity? Is it really realistic that ants could remember enough using their mushroom body? And we actually realized that the learning rule we were using in the mushroom body is a very simple one that we could actually simplify even more and just think of it as a binary activation. So maybe, sorry, I don't have the right picture, but so the idea is we'll just assume that these Kenyan cells, rather than being spiky neurons, are just simple binary units that are either on or off. So they have some threshold of input and then they're either on or off. And then we'll assume these synapses are also binary, that they just get switched on or off. So as soon as you see something that you want to remember, then you switch off that synapse. And it turns out that this is this rule is basically exactly the same as a well-known associative network described by David Wilshaw back in 1969. It's a learning rule that he used. And once you abstract it this way, then actually you can do some analytical work to actually say what should be the memory capacity as we increase the number of neurons, as we change the sparseness of this representation. So this is work done by Costas, another postdoc with me at the moment. So for example, we could calculate how many random patterns could you store in this network before there is a probability that you'd see some new pattern and think that you'd seen that pattern before. And it turns out that it's quite a lot. It depends on the number of neurons you have and the sparsity of coding. But for example, in the model that we've built, we're using a sparsity of coding about this much and about this many neurons, and you may not be able to see, but that adds up to at least 400 patterns, which if you do it every 10 centimeters, gives you at least 40 meters worth of patterns, and that's just in the environment that we were using where it's very cluttered and the ants don't go very far. If it's a less cluttered environment, you don't have to remember them so often, so you should be able to go further. So we think we're at least in the right ballpark for the capacity. And also, I mean, this is a kind of lowest estimate of the capacity because we're simplifying the network into this binary thing. If we add a bit more information, allow connections, you know, to have more levels of activation, then we can obviously store more. Okay. So the other nice thing about the binary abstraction, though, is it's also very efficient. So modeling a spiky network with thousands of neurons is not something you can do very efficiently. But if you make them into binary units, then you can actually put them on a robot. For example, on the robo-ant that I showed you earlier. So this is work that's done very recently by a visiting undergraduate student, where he basically tested this Wilshaw net, which is the same principle as the mushroom body, on a robot. And I'm just going to show you very briefly an example of this. So this was the robot had been taught along this route, so these arrows basically represent where it had learnt images. And then it has to try and retrace the route by, as I say, scanning and then choosing the direction by which looks the most familiar. And as you can see, it does a reasonable job. So this is what the robot is actually seen. Again, we filtered this at an anti-resolution, and what we also found useful was to actually have a filtering that gave more weight to the information on the horizon rather than higher and lower. But hopefully you can see that it doesn't have to go exactly on the same route, but nevertheless it makes pretty much the right decision, at least in this case, to get along the route fairly successfully. Okay. So you can believe me that it succeeds on this video. I think you don't need to watch it all the way through, but I should also be honest and say it doesn't succeed always. So in this for this particular route, it did very well. In 10 runs, it made about 2 errors, which are these the red diamonds here. The triangles are for another algorithm that wasn't working at all well, the green ones. However, when we gave it a different route, it didn't do quite as well, and it seemed to make a lot of mistakes in the same place. So there seemed to be a problem that maybe there's some places in this world, at least, that it's aliasing and therefore always making the wrong decision. And every time you put it back on the route in the same place, it makes the same wrong decision. So it's not perfect, but it's certainly encouraging. Okay, so we would like to make it work better, make it more reliable, and there's a few interesting things we could try here. And one comes from robotics, and this is where I want to emphasize, I've been emphasizing so far, know your biology, but you also need to know your robotics and what's happening in the robotics world, because quite often it's the case that problems in animal behavior already have good solutions in robotics, and indeed more widely, problems in understanding biological systems often already have solutions in engineering if we only look for them. So I'm just going to give 2 examples here of 2 ideas from robotics that we've used very successfully. So one is the idea that if you're trying to use this sort of method of how familiar is what I see at the moment, one way to do that is to use an algorithm called sequence slam that was proposed by Michael Milford, who works in Queensland Institute of Technology. So this is a very simple idea. So it's the same basic idea that you're trying to recognize where you are by just very simple comparison of images. And in particular, he was interested in using very low resolution images. So try to see how low resolution you could make these images and still get good matches. And as you can imagine, if you have very low resolution images, then the chances of getting a good match for any one image, just the one you've seen before, is, you know, you'll get a match, but you'll also get a good match to lots of other places. So what he did was to say, okay, let's just, as we go along the route, let's keep track of how good our matches are. So this is what we've stored already, and we're just saying, how well does that match? As I'm going along my route, how well does what I've seen now match to everything I've seen before? So here you can see there's a match here, which is good, but there's also a fairly good match here, and there's probably another match here, and so forth. However, if you then step along and say, okay, what's the best match here? Well, you can see there's a good match here, but not a good match. Well, a good match there, but then if you step again, it's not a good match. So basically, what he's looking for is sequences of good matches, and sequences of good matches turn out to be an extremely robust way to recognize that you are actually in the right place. And nicely, you can recognize these sequences with different slopes, so you can be moving at a different speed here to here, but still recognize the sequence because you're getting a slope in this kind of matrix of similarity. So it turns out, even just using 10 or 20 matches as your sequence, you get very reliable results. And we tested this actually in a variant. So instead of using very low resolution but grayscale images, we tried using binary images, again inspired by the ant. So the ant has ultraviolet light receptors, and people have thought for a long time that this is maybe because that lets them separate the sky from the ground very easily, which makes a very salient skyline, and that you could represent very compactly, just as a binary image, this is sky, this is ground. And it turns out that it's true that ultraviolet light works really well. So in this example, some of you may have seen this view last night from the informatics forum. You can see that if we use normal vision, and we try to separate, you know, using RGB, try to use k-means or some other method to separate sky area from other area, it's pretty bad. It basically mistakes this light area on the mirrored both the sky and it can't deal with the clouds very well, and you can see that it's really hard to find somewhere that would separate these two areas, sky versus ground. Whereas if we do it with a UV filter, it's trivial. It's really, really easy. If you just look at the intensity of UV, there's a really clear division of sky versus ground. And it turns out this is very robust to changes in the weather, to changes in the lighting conditions. In Edinburgh, changes in the weather and lighting conditions happen very frequently, so it's very, we did a nice study that showed it's really robust to that. So we then trained our robot, in this case it was actually Tom, who was doing this work, had a camera, again, with an omnidirectional view, and he did a little walk from the informatics forum and this little circuit around collecting data, and hopefully this is going to work. Earlier, so we'll see if it does something. We really honestly ran it earlier than it ran. Oh, that's really annoying. I honestly tested this half an hour ago and it was working just fine. Okay. Never mind. Okay. So, well, what that would have looked like was a view of the sky that we're getting from this camera. And then in UV, basically what you can see is this sky shape as you move along, and the sky shape is changing all the time. And it turns out the signature of the sky shape is extremely reliable cue that you can use. So then when we ran, now I can even get to the next slide. So when we ran a sequence on this, we found we could get very accurately recognize where we were. So all the green points show places where we could recover the position we were in. So if you said you had to, if you said you had to get the right position, then the recall is 81%. If we said, okay, you have to pick something as your best guess for where we are, then it's 94% correct on this route.
I did that one more go, but I think it's just something I'll do it for you.
Okay. Never mind. Okay, so another example of using taking textbook robotics and applying it to biology that we looked at, many of you will have heard of optimal cue integration, and this is literally textbook, as in this is the slide that I use in my lecture on robotics about how to do cue integration. And the basic idea is that you have two different systems that are measuring the same thing, and if you want to combine them optimally, you should combine them relative to their variance. So basically, you want to weight a particular cue relative to its variance. So if it has a higher variance, you want to give it less weight. If it has less variance, you want to give it more weight. So that's essentially what we're saying here. And that will give you a better estimate than either cue on its own. And people have got very excited about this being a principle that's used in biological systems. People have done lots of experiments on humans, for example, giving them visual cues and haptic cues, and putting those in competition for measuring the size of an object, and then if you make the visual cue blurrier and blurrier, so the noise gets greater, the variance gets greater, then you see the weighting changes significantly towards the other cue. So we wanted to do the same experiment on ants. So you'll recall that I've mentioned several times that ants have this path integration information, they also have this visual memory, and you can put those two in competition. So you can pick up an ant that's been running back and forth from the nest to a feeder, and pick it up and put it somewhere else where it can see the nest, so it can see the same view, and it should be able to align itself with that view and go towards the nest. But it also, depending on how, if it's gone this direction, it also has a vector, a path integration vector that's pointing it in a different direction. And we basically are asking which direction do the ants actually go, given that those two options, okay? And what was nice about this experiment is that we could actually control and predict just how much the variance should change So basically, as the ad goes further, the path integration obviously accumulates noise, but because ads have an external compass, they're using the visual polarization as a compass, it doesn't actually get faster all that fast. And in fact, the rate at which it gets worse, you can actually calculate. And it turns out that if you're looking at the angle that the animal is going, so note that although the estimate of the position has got worse, has got larger, the estimate of the angle has actually got smaller the further it goes. Okay? So the angular error should decrease, should be less noisy the further it's gone along its path integration up there. And in fact, you can show that it should be proportional to 1 over the distance that it goes. And that gives you an expression for how much, if they're weighting the two things, how much the weighting should change, okay, as they go longer along the distances. So we have one thing we have to make an assumption about, which is where at what point would these two things be equal? So we don't know the actual variance of the view, but there must be some distance at which the variance of the view and the variance of the path integration would be the same. So that's the one variable we have to play with here. And so we tested the ants under these circumstances. So we picked them up at 1 meter, at 0, 1, 3, and 7 meters, and looked to see which direction they took. And indeed, it does depend on the path integration method. So if you put them in somewhere unfamiliar and they have no path integration, then they're just going any direction, but otherwise they'll go in the path integration direction because they have nothing else to go on. But if they can also see a familiar view, you can see that at 0 meters they'll use it, at 1 meter they wait, they go somewhere in between, at 3 meters they go slightly more towards the path integration direction, and by 7 meters they're going towards the path integration. So there seems to be this exactly what we predicted, that they should go, they weight the path integration more because that angular error is getting smaller and smaller, whereas the view error is the same all the time. And if we just plot this data a different way, we can actually see this really works. So this is the length of the vector. Each individual point is a direction that an ant went, where this would be going towards the nest or the view, and this is going in the path integration direction. You can see it's very noisy, but if you look at the mean directions of the ants, they actually, the means line up extremely well with what we predict mathematically based on the direction of uncertainty. So it's actually a very, very good fit that they do seem to be weighting these cues optimally. And one, with only one free parameter to do this fit. And it fits better, for example, than just assuming that the weighting goes linearly with the distance, or linearly with the distance, but only up to some point at which, you know, path integration takes over. We couldn't get as good a fit as we could to this assumption that it actually be the optimal integration. So does the ant actually, as people have claimed for these experiments in humans, they've said, okay, that means what we do in our brain, we must be representing both the cue and the uncertainty of the cue so that we can make this calculation. So is the ant actually calculating with an internal estimate of its uncertainty? So we did another experiment to try and test this. So as I've said so far, if the ant has a straight path, then the uncertainty of its path integration vector changes with the distance. However, if an ant doesn't have a straight path, but does a very complex path, it's also increasing its uncertainty, but now the length of its vector is not increasing. It's still only, so for example, if you make an ant run around in a plot for a while, it's still at the same distance from the nest. Its path integration distance was still 3 meters in this case, but it's accumulated the kind of error that it should have accumulated if it had gone 30 meters. So we would expect it should weight the PIQ less because it's got greater uncertainty. But what we found is that in fact they don't. They behave almost exactly the same whether or not we add this extra running around part. So they weight the Q about the same amount. So it looks like what they're actually doing is using the length of their home vector as a proxy for this is how uncertain I am. They're not actually storing the real uncertainty, but they're storing a proxy, which is the distance that they need to go, which is a piece of information that they have to keep. So our current assumption is that they're actually using this weighting on based on the PI length as a kind of proxy that they've evolved for how much they should trust their path integration. The longer my path integration vector is, the more I should trust it and not my visual information. But nevertheless, that weighting has, even if it's an evolved weighting, it has actually evolved to meet the optimal weighting, not just a simple linear weighting or something else.
Okay, so have I got a few more minutes? I hope. I'm not sure who's actually in charge of time here. Right, okay. So the obvious question then is, you know, where and how in the brain could this cube integration combination be occurring? So I'm going to race through a little bit the last bit, but I'm very excited about this, our really most recent work. And the final message I want to give here is that I think modeling early and modeling often is the main thing I want to impress everybody to do, because you really, really learn about a problem and about a system if you try and model it. And you should do that even if it breaks all the previous rules I've said. So even if you're doing it completely in simulation, you're ignoring the neural information, you haven't really studied the animal that well, etc., etc., it's still good to build a simple, bad model, because building the model, the process of building the model, gives you a lot of information. Okay, so our hypothesis about where this is happening in the ant brain is that it's in the central complex. So this is abbreviated as CX. So this is a beautiful picture from Stanley Heinzer that shows this area of the insect brain, which is a very small area right in the middle of the brain. That's why it's called the central complex. And it has a really interesting structure where the neurons pass information back and forth across both sides in a very, very organized way, which I'll show you in more detail in a moment. And this circuit has become known from this really nice work by Stanley and Louis Homburg, where they looked at the polarized light pathway, in this case in locus. So they showed, basically, as I said, the sky has a polarization pattern, it is used as a compass tool. So what they do is to rotate a polarizer above the animal while they're recording from this area of the brain. And what they see is these neurons that respond in a very clear way to a particular direction of polarization. And in fact, it turned out that across this little area of the central complex, which is called the pericerebral ridge, there's this really orderly array of this neuron responds to this direction, then this one to this direction, and this one to this direction. So it's like a little map of the directions of the polarization into this circuit. So, more recently, and this is still unpublished work from Stanley, he's shown that actually this part of the brain also gets information about speed. There's some neurons that go into the base of the central complex that actually respond according to speed. So if you show them optical flow stimuli, so stimuli going past them like this, their response basically scales very nicely with the velocity. So just again, to be quick, that's roughly what's happening. So you're getting a spiking rate that corresponds to the velocity. So we have the two elements we need for path integration, i.e. direction and velocity. So the first hypothesis, maybe that's then what's going on here, is that this area of the brain is actually storing the information about path integration, and specifically it's doing it basically by integrating the information about the direction with the speed in a kind of distributed array. So I can explain this most easily by actually referring to a model that we came up with almost 10 years ago, a completely hypothetical model that wasn't based on any known neuroscience, that said maybe one way to do path integration is to integrate the speed in different directions. So here the idea is you have these are the direction cells that are responding depending on which way the animal is heading, the green ones, and they're feeding into these memory cells that basically sum up the speed for that direction. So you basically end up in these memory cells with a distributed representation of where you've been. And the extra thing we came up with here was that rather than then using that to directly read out and calculate the vector, was that instead we said, okay, maybe how you use this to go home is that these cells are also connected to what we call steering cells on the outside here, in such a way that if you're heading in this direction and your memory is strong in that direction, then you get equal, that's not a good example. If you're heading in this direction, but your memory says is stronger in this direction, then that will make you turn to the right. And similarly, if your memory is stronger in this direction, it will make you turn to the left, and so forth. So the balance across all these left-right cells will actually steer you back in the direction you need to go to get home.
So that was our second hypothesis about this structure, is that maybe these steering cells also exist in the central context. And so Stanley gave us this map of all the things that he had actually, all the neurons that he's traced painstakingly through the central complex. And as you can see, it looks like a bit of a mess, although actually there's a lot of organization here. You can see this kind of crossing patterns that are very consistent, very well mapped, have been shown in lots of different insects, in fact. So they seem to be strongly preserved across different insects. And if you kind of rearrange this map a little bit to try and get a better idea of what it looks like, you can draw it like this. So here, we're identifying cells in the protocerebral bridge that do the direction, represent direction. The speed information is coming from these other cells that I showed you. We're hypothesizing that these cells in the middle are the memory cells that add up these two things, and then they connect to these cells that we know are output cells. And then what, as I say, Stanley knew about was that there was all this connectivity, this pattern of connectivity that looks a little bit suggestive of what we want, because there seems to be this kind of funny shift, you know, from one, from this direction here, it shifts across one step to this one here and so forth. But it wasn't really clear what it was doing. And then my student, Tom Stone, had a very nice idea of, let's just put this into a force graph, which basically takes all this connectivity and tries to find the shortest path to represent the whole system using the shortest paths. And what it turned out to be was a perfect ring architecture for steering. So we even found there were cells that closed the loop. We had this linear array of cells, but in fact some of them actually do the exactly the connection you need to close the loop up. And so this is literally, this is a diagram based on the exact wiring that we know in the central complex. But it's also exactly the same principle as the model that I showed you earlier, at least suggested about 10 years ago. So we basically have this, the direction cells in the middle here. They're going to memory cells, which add up information with speed. And then it's the joint activation of the current direction and your memory direction to determine whether you're going to turn right or left. And it's just instead of three directions, we now have eight directions. And so let me just show you, this one will work, I'm sure, how this works kind of in a little simulation. So we can have an animal foraging from the nest. So the arrow shows the direction that it's heading. And hopefully you'll be able to see that basically the middle directional ring is activated according to how the direction that it's going, the current compass direction. And that information is being gradually integrated in the central ring, which is basically the memory. So you can see as it goes further and further northwards from the nest, it's getting stronger and stronger activation. Actually, again, we're doing an inhibition thing, so it's getting stronger activation in the direction that it came from. And eventually we switch it so that it now uses this information to go home. So we switch on the steering, and what happens is that the activation of the steering cells depends on this difference. So here, for example, it's not pointing this direction, but this memory is strong, so it wants to turn right. And this is balanced across the whole ring, and that determines which way it turns. So it will make a turn and head for home. This is just here, you can see it's now facing the wrong way, so now it wants to turn left because this one is most activated. And we'll actually take the simulated agent directly home. And what we also find is when it gets home, because this integration is still happening, gradually the memory cells are balancing themselves out again. And so when it gets home, it also spontaneously, we get this emergent searching behavior as it moves away from the nest, and then that causes it to be unbalanced, which goes back to the nest, which causes it to go away, and so on. So we actually get search behavior out as well. Okay. So, and I'll skip that one and just say, again, this works. We've tested it in lots and lots of different situations, at least in the simulated world, with quite a lot of noise. So we add different amounts of noise, up to 10 or 20% noise, and over half lengths of up to 1,000 steps, it works extremely well. We get very low error in how far it takes to get back, how far it is from home when it comes home. Okay, so I think it's probably time for me to finish. I'll give my final tip, which is try and work with good people. So these are current postdocs in my lab, except for Mike, who's just got a job elsewhere. So let me thank all the people who have helped for the work that I've described here, this set of postdocs in particular, a number of PhD students, also a number of very good, excellent undergraduate students, and of course, working with colleagues from other universities and the people who fund this. Thank you.
We have a few minutes for questions. Thank you, beautiful talk. I'd like to raise a really weird issue of looking to have a water all the way. I'd like to challenge, if I may, the choice of single water. In particular, particularly in this case, if you think about the perceptual model, so you chose to use the frame-based input. So every input is kind of like that. As we know in biology, the actual input is event-based. So only the pixels that experience the change fire spikes in the rest of the time. This would change the entire coding of the input, goes from the eye to the brain, instead of having this frame kind of great code of the frame that I do not, you have a network of events coming one after the other, which change the entire encoding scheme and the entire tractor would be the entire trajectory of the single frame. So would you consider in this case, you know, as a good thing to have these two models competing and seeing which one?
So yeah, I absolutely agree that having more than one model is a really good idea. In fact, a really important strategy is not to just pick a model and that's your model, but to really often try and say, well, could I build a different model? What would happen if I did a different model? In this particular case, we've looked a little bit at trying to use object flow input instead of using just the visual input. But so far, we haven't got really particularly great results with that. But we haven't really explored it fully. But I think it's definitely, you know, at the moment, we're kind of doing it like snapshots. And I agree that's probably not what the app does. So we're also interested, yeah, just trying to make it a more continuous input. I think for the purposes of this model, what we didn't want to do is make too many assumptions about the visual processing, because we wanted to understand if the later principle was working without it being the visual processing that was actually solving the problem in the first place. So that's why we kept the visual processing extremely simple in this example.
Thank you very much for the beautiful talk and the tips. I have another question. You have emphasized the individual behavior. Is there any evidence of collective behavior in the context of this visual based navigation system?
So largely not. I mean, obviously it's collective in that they're all trying to bring food back to the nest rather than eat it for themselves. There's some evidence that they may be able to either communicate a little bit where the food is, but it's really one paper that's kind of a little bit inconclusive. Also, sometimes you see what looks like maybe they can follow each other to some extent, so there may be visual information of another ant going past. But in terms of actual, you know, how the visual information works, it seems to be the individual ant is the key. Yeah. So that's what we're focusing on.
Are they doing the visual scanning by stopping the scanning or doing their own?
Yeah, no, that's a great question because, yeah, what the ants don't do is they sometimes stop and scan, but only when they're lost. If they know where they're going, they don't scan. But what they do, or what you do see, is that there is some wobble. And in fact, Mike has actually done a model where instead of having the scanning, he had the size of the wobble increases as things become less familiar, basically, and you also slow down. And those two things together will also get you nicely along the path.
Yes. Okay. And you've got a spiking model and also a binary model in the same system. As I said, it was not only left the spiking model.
So, I mean, we actually did the spiking model first and then simplified to the binary one in this case. What should we get? I mean, I think doing this spiking model helped us just believe that it wasn't, you know, that it was more, that this is what the brain could be doing. It had the same kind of properties that the brain system had. So it's more kind of an accident of how we got there, I guess, that we did the spiking model first. But I think if I'd done the binary model first, I wouldn't have been so convinced that there wasn't, you know, if I was just using some associative net, from the literature and shown that that works. I wouldn't know if this were arriving at it by going via a detailed model of this area of the brain and then realizing the logic of that area of the brain really mapped very well onto this hypothetical associated net. I think it was a much better learning experience in that way. So it made it much more convincing to me that this is really maybe what's going on in the brain.
What you're proposing is that the ant follows an active perception approach towards communication. The assumption that assumes that the world of the ant is not broken, and that might have changed. Is that really true?
For the foraging lifetime of the average ant, that's pretty true.
Okay.
Yeah, they usually don't live more than a week or so.
Because I'm thinking the desert, the desert ants in the desert environments, and then there's some pretty much changes in the landscape.
Right, so I think if there's dramatic change, you do see that ants seem to start again with these short journeys.
Okay.
So I think they realize when everything's unfamiliar and that they should do something different.
Right.
But at least in the world, in the place where we're working, the environment where we're working, there's not usually those dramatic changes unless we make them ourselves by chopping down bushes and things.
All right, Barbara, thank you very much for a fantastic talk.